Hello. Thank you for inviting me. So my name is Jana Pavlová, and maybe I will go directly to the topic. So architecture of banking socialism referred to a specific phase in the history of the Czech Republic after the Velvet Revolution in 1989, defined by the period of building capitalism under the Václav Klaus government till its fall in 1997. This age was satirically called the era of innocence. Neoliberal theories and their neoconservative modifications became an inspiration for architects of transformation led by the reform economist and former Minister of Finance Václav Klaus. They designed a specific privatization method. Contrary to the neoliberal vision of maximum reduction of the role of the state in the economy, as Milton Friedman characterized it, the state interest retained in the Czech version. In this hybrid or soft form of capitalism, the state remained the strategic owner of the largest financial institution in the country. They established the most important privatization funds, which included state-owned companies formerly privatized in so-called coupon privatization. Very often, they would find themselves in situations where, for business reason or based on a political assignment, banks had very close relations with the very companies they were controlling through the fund structures. That is how situations of a bank owning a company, giving it credit and running it not too well at the same time came to exist, despite the bank itself being owned by the state. In many respects, it was not really in the state's interest for a bank to force companies controlled in this way, neither as owner nor creditor, to make the radical changes which were necessary in basically all sectors back then. As the hierarchical structures of the former state property were restored, it leads to the conclusion that in the 90s the transformation did not actually happen. The former Communist Planning Commission was de facto replaced by a large banking trio, Commercial Bank, Czech Saving Bank, and Investment and Postbank. Banking socialism represented an informal institutionalized economic corruption, where for a long-term period, hidden costs of transformation were saved in the banking sector as insolvency debts. This is quite a funny depiction of a new situation. After the revolution, it was not longer the Communist Party whose name was carried on transparent in a parade of important events, but the bank as a general sponsor. Physical infrastructure of banking socialism was consisted of newly emerging bank and saving banks buildings for which the most exposed location of Czech cities were chosen. We could find them on squares, main streets, where they often founded the new business centers, many copies of Wall Street, or on the main roads, commercial strips. In addition to new buildings, a number of branches were built by the reconstruction of existing buildings, some of which were formerly part of the bureaucratic network of the previous regime. Building reconstruction here de facto embodied a metaphor or transformation, building political and economic economic democracy on the ruins of communism. This building of the former General Directorate of Industrial Chemistry Works in Pardubice, later called Unicem, was bought and reconstructed by Investment and Postbank. In the new post-revolutionary code, it became a dominant part of a forming financial, administrative, and commercial center on base of the former socialist industrial structure. The significance of this building for the city in the former era was supported by the fact that we could even find it as a cutout in one of the teenager magazine issue. Called ABC, which was in this way promoting important companies of the state economy in the time of real socialism. The identity of banking socialism was formed by newly established banking institutions with respect to their chief role in the process of economic transformation. The biggest boom in the building of bank branches was happening by the end of 1995, which corresponds to the period of boom of the Czechoslovak economy. We could even hear the euphoric voices that were knighting the Czech Republic on a Central European tiger. The whole of society perceived business or entrepreneurship as something positive, healthy, and revitalizing. Banking absorbed this mood and simultaneously served as its source. As the backbone of the market economy and as the privatization agent, the banking sector had to represent such values that would drive the economic boom and would lead to the building of the healthy and self-confident state. Due to their function in the economic transformation, banking institutions created an identity of the mass privatization project. They should consolidate the population trust in the executed transformation steps that led to the form of capitalism that could have actually collapsed at any moment. At the beginning of the 90s, banks did not develop a more complex concept of corporate identity as they have it today. It was realized only on the level of logos and corporate colors. But even this minimum was not kept or respected. Since the main face of the bank was created on the level of the bank branch, in the state of absence of rules, the character of the bank's identity was shaped on a pluralistic basis of specific architects' approaches to design concept of individual bank buildings. Banks and saving banks have become the first major commissions for the architecture studios and helped them to start their own business in the first post-revolutionary years. Due to the benevolence of the investor and the smooth administrative processes, these commissions represent a dream for architects who spent so many years in state constructing and planning institutes. Architect Martin Reinisch excellently described this optimism. Bank, among other buildings, has to be what a Rolls-Royce is among other cars. Banks tend to be very juicy buildings, from slightly ironic temples of money to exclusive structures and materials, symbols of a market and a marketplace, information, operations, public auditoriums and spaces, such a series of articulate components and symbolism. That is the most tempting challenge there can be in our profession. It is a really delicate task. An ideologically motivated effort to cut off from the language of socialist modernism, as well as the belief that the new era must be a radical change, generating a general tendency to create artistic icons, radical gestures that would be signed on the face of cities. In this respect, there has often been an attempt to get closer to the styles of the West architectural stars. This is the case of the commercial bank in Ostrava. Its author admits that he was influenced by Richard Mayer so much that he felt as if he had been his disciple. He created de facto a doppelganger, a tribute to the American star architect. The fear of uncritical acceptance of culture patterns from the West has led many architects to tend to seek lessons in their own national history. The former Legiobanka Bank complex shows a unique coexistence of the Art Deco national style, represented here by famous architect Josef Gočar, and of functionalism, represented here by František Marek. That board embodies the glory of Czechoslovak banking in the First Republic. The high quality standard of the banking design, which they represent, became the most common reference model for the bank identity formation after the revolution, following the resurrection of the Czech banking industry. The architect Marek Houska had a unique chance to be directly at the source during the renovation of the Legiobanka complex in early 90s. He opted for an extensive reconstruction of the original premises in the postmodern style of neo-Gočar disguise. The Art Deco national The Art Deco National Start was symbolically renewed at the time when the desire for decorativism in the late postmodern Occident again gained social and political aspects, accompanying the euphoria caused by the creation of democratic state. The borders here between the Art Deco National Start and postmodern decorativism, similarly to the borders between functionalism and neo-functionalism, disappear in the imitation. At some places, the mutual confrontation creates a semantic tension. The similar tendency is apparent in the design approach of Vladimir Štulc and Jan Werner, who wanted to follow the visual form of banking interiors designed in the 20s and 30s of the 20th century. In the case of the savings bank in Jindřichův Hradec, the use of the language of postmodernism is apparent as a result of a work with the different modernist memory, early laws, constructivism, brutalism. The architects, however, are strictly against such labeling. Maybe Los Ambil design of the Josephine Baker House in the 1927 could serve as a striking reminiscence for this blue and white diagonal structure of the facade, but actually it rather refers to an imitation of the work of the Swiss architect Mario Botta, very popular in the local context since the late 80s in the Czechoslovak Then the actual integration of artwork into architecture here still stems from the legacy of the previous regime, when architects had to pay up to 4% of the total construction cost for artistic decoration. As the neighboring church, the new Czech National Bank in Ústí nad Labem wanted to become an equal landmark of the city and a solid and democratic institution as a strong foundation stone for the new capitalist society. This should be based on postmodern dialogue connecting forms of the most acclaimed periods of Czech architecture, Baroque and interval functionalism. The revival of values of these two strong culture traditions was, according to the author, an impulse for searching for the identity of contemporary Czech architecture. Many architects in the post-revolutionary atmosphere showed a tendency to understand architecture rather as an act of emotional expression than a rationally settled concept that at the same time did not always lead to a ready shape. Lots of critics in this case speaks about the aspect of non-design. Perhaps the most characteristic motif in this respect was the replacement of the rigid polygonal morphology of right angles, the main feature of the design of 80s in the socialist context, by the softening organic curve, which was not only the expression of an advent of more advanced technology, which came in 90s, but above all, a certain material manifestation of the liberation of space. For many architects, to use an organic curve or other hybrid, humorous or eclectic features meant a certain form of rebellion and a path to freedom from the well-established functionalist methods. These tendencies of the search for the bank's identity as a modern, dynamically developing institution should correspond to the post-revolutionary transformation of the life form of post-socialist society. In this respect, the Czech savings bank in České Budějovice brings a very specific postmodern commentary on the post-communist situation. The rhetorical figure of breaking the old orders is symbolized by a romanticizing form of a ruin. The modern glass facade reacts to the neighboring socialist building with Boletický panel facade. By stemming from the aesthetic of the condemned normalization architecture, which the architects transform into part of the overall architecture world in postmodern collage, it gave rise to an entirely unique metaphor indicating an attitude of dealing with our own past. Thanks to its new semantic value, normalization architecture here then de facto get rid of its former ideology. The architects of this Czechoslovak commercial bank wanted to embody in their concept an identity of a bank as a house full of emotions in the hectic era of the post-revolution times. They called it a poetic machine. Hybridity, vitality, audacity, or poetic creation of střítecký and crew power design, however, create a new basis of moral message in their effort to free the architectural language and to break the conservative mind setting of the society. They asked the painter of local dance clubs, the Roma boy Pali Paštika, to participate on the interior's graphic completion. The contrasting folksiness and naivety of Paštika's work when compared to technological demanding and costly elements of the building is even more accentuated by the fact that it's cost what a decorator's work would cost. Not even the architects perceive their work as extravagant, but rather describe it as a normal house. A building of lively temperament in German-oriented culture, where one of the most pressing issues is xenophobia. Architects here try to avoid the return to the legacy of functionalism and also the postmodern deconstruction approaches, so they found their own style. They managed to transfer a strict technicist high-tech style, which was developed especially in England, into the local culture context and construction condition and created a specifically soft form that they themselves called the Moravian variety of cold high-tech. Architects thus don't want to create a distance between bank and client, but they want to create a friendly face of the institution. As they said, we wanted to achieve the state that it would be, as Germans call it, gemütlich, nice, warm, pleasant, with a human touch. Due to their large number and the representative power after the revolution, lots of bank buildings became the main part of the polemic around the role of modernism and postmodernism in the process of transformation, which was understood on the one hand as an act of rehumanization, democratization, and a return to Europe, and on the other hand as an extension of the neoliberal monopoly. The postmodern features, as they had taken shape in Western architectural discourse, such as irony, pastiche, nihilism, radical eclecticism, hybridity, the double coding, contextualism, gained in the post-socialist context different moral and ideological connotations and values. Postmodernism referred here to direct architectural embodiment of the post-revolution wave of optimism caused by the liberation, but due to the character of the commissions that began to represent the newly emerging business class quickly reached in the process of privatization, postmodernism also came to symbolize the wealth inequality in society. As an echo of cultural logic of late capitalism, it was developed during Reagan's era in the USA and Thatcher's era in Great Britain during the 80s. The moral hazard accompanying the process of privatization, and in particular the political pressure exerted on banks to serve as pillars of transformation, which meant to provide unpayable loans to privatized companies, brought the country into the economic crisis in 1997. Bank buildings have thus become a symbolic representation of architecture and ethical failure, collectively referred to as low declining or commercial postmodernism. Many theorists in the characterization of this architecture talk about unobstructive gestures, parasit on modernism, inappropriate eclecticism. The architecture of money temples was used as a reference to unethical conditions in society and on political scene, and labeled them as a clear indicators of mismanaged privatization. One of them was the most acclaimed architecture critic, Rostislav Švácha. He said in account of these buildings, instead of supporting its schools and cultural institutions, the Czech state protects poorly managed and poorly controlled, in other words, tunneled banks to this day. Before they went into bankruptcy and succeeded at receiving state-provided support, these banks managed to build a number of various strange postmodern deconstructivist headquarters. Their clients and architects often attempt to at least partially imitate Prague's dancing house by Frank Gehry and Vlado Milunič. The debate on the social dimension of postmodernism seems to be still unresolved, and postmodernism has become, in a black and white perspective, an ideological underpinned term linked to the cultural logic of neoliberalism as defined by leftist intellectuals in the Western context of the 80s. Does schematic automatism in accepting this definition prevent to revising the concept of postmodernism again? Does the interpretation of postmodernism as a cultural logic in the service of neoliberalism is expected as a definitive norm? The initial penetration of market economy principles brought into confusion, incompleteness and dysfunction real freedom. In the era of innocence, architects had a real freedom and completely unique opportunity to use their own creativity. Lots of them say that this was the last opportunity to create an architecture, like as a part of art. Despite the fact that they were often accused of populism by critics, their works in most cases did not correspond with the taste of the general society. People hate this building. In the contrary, even with the possible time, these buildings are still provocative and out of the system for the majority of society. But the critics have already begun to access these buildings as example of punk architecture, for example. Banks and savings bank from 90s remain one of the last most problematic examples of architectural heritage today. It is still unclear if we accept them as a part of our cultural identity or not. However, the layer of this heritage is quickly disappearing. The fate that often meets these buildings symbolizes their stigma. They become monuments of the casino economy, referred to the period of banking socialism. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation.
Any questions to the presenter? Send one.
Well, thank you. Some of the examples were quite outstanding. I would like to ask, do the bank, as clients, were asking for some special aesthetics or some special architecture in most cases?
Not. Architects had really freedom. Yeah, it was according to their own concept. That they create their own concept of identity for each bank. So yeah, it was quite really, they had quite free hands.
And how many of these buildings still exist in Czech, and how many of the interiors still exist, because that's the most fragile part of
It depends according to the money that investor had to reconstruct them. But the main tendency is to make a new identity, so it is only it depends only on money. Yes. So, but some of them still exist, but a lot of them were partly reconstructed, or it depends.
Okay. Any more question? No, I have one. Can we place these buildings in the career of the architects somewhere? Because from this point of view of banking socialism, it is very integrate view we have on this, but within the career, how they relate to these buildings?
In what?
In the careers
in
of the
career
architects.
Of architects.
Yes.
These buildings are quite a taboo. It's quite a problematic. They often don't want to show them on their portfolios. It's quite often that their children after appreciate the art of their fathers. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much for your presentation, Jana.
Thank you.